The world watches the night sky in anticipation. Nukes have been deployed across Mars and will be detonated simultaneously. There's a bright flash of light as the red dot in the sky is replaced by a white glow. The bombs have gone off on Mars and now bathe its surface in intense heat and radiation. The hope is that by nuking the crap out of the red planet, we can terraform it into a hospitable place for humans to live. But will this actually work? Let's find out. Nuking Mars as a means of terraforming the planet was brought to the public's attention by Elon Musk on a late-night talk show. It's important to keep in mind that Elon is not a scientist. He does not have an advanced degree in the sciences, nor has he ever published a peer-reviewed study pertaining to any of the sciences. Yes, he does have a BS in physics, yet unfortunately most of his coursework was in solid-state physics, which does not make him an expert in geology, biology, climate physics, or pretty much anything to do with terraforming. We just want to bring this to your attention and point out that he's not the most credible source for science-related information. Therefore, when he says something like, "Dropping thermonuclear weapons over the poles would allow us to terraform Mars," his statement should be taken with a grain of salt. To be fair, anyone wearing a Nuke Mars t-shirt probably shouldn't be the first person you ask for ideas on how to terraform our neighboring planet. But could Elon Musk's plan be so crazy that it could work? The basic premise behind nuking Mars is to release greenhouse gases into the atmosphere that would warm up the planet. Currently, the average temperature of Mars is around negative 81 degrees Fahrenheit. Obviously, this is inhospitable for humans and pretty much every life form on planet Earth. In order to increase the temperature of our neighboring planet, we need to put more greenhouse gases in the atmosphere so that heat can be retained. Now, keep in mind, we are somewhat experts on how to do this as we are dumping greenhouse gases into our own atmosphere every day. This is what's driving climate change and leading to the global temperature increase on our planet. However, unlike Mars, we shouldn't be warming Earth as it'll have drastic consequences for humans and all living things on our planet. But you might be surprised to learn that what we're doing to our planet today may actually help us terraform Mars in the future. Currently, the majority of Mars's atmosphere is made up of carbon dioxide, which is an important greenhouse gas, but there's just not enough of it. Water vapor is also a greenhouse gas that can increase the planet's temperature. Since Mars has a decent amount of water frozen at its poles, nuking them could convert the ice into water vapor, which then would be released into the atmosphere. The combination of CO2, H2O, and other greenhouse gases in Earth's atmosphere is what keeps our planet so toasty and allows us to live so comfortably on it. So Elon's idea is to change the composition of Mars's atmosphere to allow it to retain heat and become our second home. In theory, nuking Mars would most certainly release water vapor and even more CO2 into the atmosphere, but there are a couple of problems with the plan. A recent study conducted by Bruce Jakowski and Christopher Edwards, two scientists from the University of Colorado Boulder and Northern Arizona University Flagstaff, respectively, has shown that there just isn't enough ice on Mars to change the temperature of the planet, even if it all was vaporized and deposited into the atmosphere by nukes. This puts a huge hole in Elon's plans for terraforming the planet, although this doesn't seem to be a deterrent for the owner of SpaceX and Tesla. Elon has also stated that by nuking Mars, CO2 stored in the planet's rocks and crust would be released into the atmosphere, but again, the actual scientists who have analyzed the data have concluded that there isn't enough CO2 contained within the surface rocks on Mars to warm up the planet to hospitable levels. The reason for this is that Martian rocks are very different from Earth rocks. The rocks on the Earth contain a lot of CO2, like limestone, and get help from microbes that sequester carbon within them. It's a mixing of living and non-living processes that allow high amounts of carbon to get trapped within the rocks of Earth. On Mars, however, those biotic processes do not take place. The only process that traps CO2 within the rocks of Mars is the slow seeping of molecules from the atmosphere into the surface of the planet. This is not a very efficient process. But the lack of significant amounts of CO2 and water on Mars is not the only problem that Elon's plan faces. Unlike Earth, the red planet does not have a magnetic field protecting it. This means that solar winds tend to eject gases from Mars's atmosphere into space. With every lost particle, the greenhouse gases that were put into the atmosphere by the nukes would be reduced, eventually returning the Martian atmosphere into its original composition. On top of this, scientists have noted that even though Mars is smaller than Earth, its distance from the Sun requires that it have a similar atmospheric pressure as Earth in order to support human life. Its atmosphere also needs to contain the same amount of CO2 as Earth in order to warm the planet to suitable temperatures. However, it's estimated that even if the entire planet were nuked to release the water from the ice caps and carbon dioxide into the air, the resulting gases would only make Mars's atmospheric pressure 1.2% of Earth's. This is not nearly high enough, which further hinders the Nuke Mars plan. What the science tells us is that Elon's plan to nuke Mars would not result in the planet being terraformed. There would be an increase in greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, but it would not be enough to significantly alter the climate of the planet. And on top of that, there's a pretty obvious negative side effect to using nuclear weapons to blow up the surface of an entire planet. Detonating nukes comes with a large amount of radiation. If we detonated enough nukes to liberate all the water from the ice caps and surface rocks, the entire planet would be irradiated from the bombs. This kind of defeats the purpose of terraforming, because humans would not be able to step foot on the surface until the radiation levels went down. It would likely take a very long time for the radiation to reach acceptable levels, but since no one has ever nuked an entire planet before, it's hard to tell exactly how long. There is reason to believe that it could take decades before we'd be safe to send an expedition to Mars after detonating nukes across the planet, and it could be even longer before it'd be safe to grow plants on the Martian surface. Another nasty consequence of blowing up Mars with nukes is that it could send the planet into a nuclear winter. Again, it kind of defeats the purpose of terraforming the planet if we can't live on it. If enough dust and particles were kicked up into the atmosphere, they could block the sun's light from reaching the Martian surface. This would cause the temperature to drop even lower than it currently is. Eventually, the particles would settle out of the atmosphere, and at that point, the temperature would start to rise. But since we know there isn't enough water or carbon dioxide on the surface of the planet to raise the temperature to adequate levels, nuking Mars is not a great option. So, the Nuke Mars plan is pretty silly, especially if the end goal is to terraform the planet. But is there a different way to terraform Mars so that humans could someday live on it? There absolutely is, and you wouldn't even have to detonate a single bomb. In order for Mars to be terraformed into a planet that humans could live on without spacesuits, the global temperature needs to increase significantly. The Nuke Mars plan had the right idea of putting greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, but its method of execution was all wrong. The first step should be to stop the loss of greenhouse gases from solar storms and high-energy particles from the sun. When these phenomena interact with the Martian atmosphere, they can cause molecules such as CO2 and H2O to be ejected into space. In order to stop this from happening, a former NASA scientist has an idea. Jim Green has developed a plan to block the sun's harmful effects on Mars's atmosphere. Green has proposed that humans could launch a series of spacecraft to set up a magnetic shield between Mars and the sun. The shield would act as a kind of clear umbrella that blocks harmful radiation while allowing certain wavelengths of light to reach the red planet. The shield itself would not block all of the sun's light, but instead protect Mars in a similar way to how Earth's magnetic field protects our planet. This would prevent molecules in Mars's atmosphere from being ejected to the depths of space and allow them to build up over time. By reducing the number of greenhouse gases lost in this way, the Martian atmosphere would become thicker and cause the planet to warm up. This would allow Mars to begin the terraforming process without any human intervention on the planet itself. It would be an incredibly slow process and would not result in a habitable Mars. But it would definitely be a step in the right direction, and one that humans need to consider if we're going to live on the planet. The trickiest part of the whole thing is putting the shield in the right place. Precise calculations would need to be made to ensure that the magnetic shield follows the orbit of Mars and keeps it protected. If the magnetic shield deviated from its course by even a few millimeters, Mars would no longer be in its shadow, and the sun's radiation would strip particles from the atmosphere again. Right now, we have the technology to start planning for the magnetic shield, but calculations and contingency plans need to be put in place before a successful mission can be launched. The protective shield will not get the job done all on its own. We still need to find a way to put more greenhouse gases into the Martian atmosphere. Although there isn't enough CO2 on the surface rocks of Mars, there might be enough deeper within the planet. This means that nuking the surface would release a small amount of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, but to successfully terraform Mars, we need to go deeper. Minerals located further underground could contain more CO2 than the surface, and therefore might be the location where we find the greenhouse gases we need to make Mars hospitable for humans. The problem with this plan is that the entire surface of Mars would need to be mined first. This would be a drilling operation on a massive scale. We currently don't have the technology to do this. However, in the future, you can imagine a humongous fleet of autonomous robots that are sent to Mars to continuously harvest and vaporize rocks and release their stored carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. It's estimated that by mining the surface of the entire planet down to a depth of 100 yards, we might be able to release enough greenhouse gases into the atmosphere to increase the temperature of the planet. However, we don't actually know if there's enough CO2 contained within the buried Martian rocks and minerals to create the desired effect, even if the whole planet is strip mined. We're working with best estimates, but until we put boots on the ground and learn more about the red planet, this scenario is only based on what little data we have available. The other problem with the harvesting method is that it would require a massive amount of energy in order to vaporize the number of rocks and minerals needed to terraform the planet. Even if we detonated all the nukes we currently have on Mars, it wouldn't be enough. Scientists think the only way to generate adequate constant energy is by using a source of fusion power similar to the sun. However, we do not have the technology to create a fusion reactor yet, which means we have a lot of work to do before we can vaporize the surface of Mars. Theoretically, if humans could develop a machine capable of generating a fusion reaction, and could put a magnetic shield between Mars and the Sun, terraforming could begin. There is a concern that a lot of the planet would need to be destroyed just to increase its temperature, but it might be necessary if we're ever going to live on the red planet. There are a few other methods that humans could use to change the climate of the planet. Unfortunately, we still need to develop the technology to carry out this next terraforming method successfully, and even then, it'll be incredibly destructive. Another way we might change the atmospheric composition of Mars and turn it into a livable planet could be by bombarding it with asteroids. All the nukes in the world aren't as powerful as slamming a giant asteroid into the red planet. But asteroids come with another benefit besides just packing an enormous punch that can vaporize the Martian surface. Some scientists believe that by capturing a large asteroid full of ice and ammonia, we can deliver the energy needed to release water and carbon dioxide into the atmosphere while simultaneously adding more greenhouse gases to the planet. The ice trapped within the asteroid could evaporate into the Martian atmosphere after impact. And the ammonia also serves as its own greenhouse gas. Between the energy released on impact that will convert the Martian surface into usable greenhouse gases, as well as the water and ammonia contained within the asteroid, the terraforming process could be sped up dramatically. There are definitely some logistical issues with this plan, such as how to harvest asteroids from the asteroid belt. But the technology to nudge space rocks in the direction of Mars is something we have right now. By landing a craft on the surface of an asteroid and using its thrusters to push the asteroid one way or the other, scientists could aim it at Mars. The tricky part will be finding asteroids with the right composition, and it'd be nice if they were in the general vicinity of Mars. Using asteroids to terraform Mars will take time. Missions will need to be carried out to identify the composition of the candidates, and then moving a 10 billion ton asteroid will not be easy. However, once it's set on the right trajectory, its momentum will carry the space rock straight through Mars's atmosphere and slam it into the planet. This will generate around 130 million megawatts of power, and the impact alone is calculated to raise the temperature of the planet by around 35 degrees. This change in temperature would likely result in some of the ice caps on Mars melting, which means the asteroid would not need to be directly aimed at the poles to cause the Martian water to evaporate into the atmosphere. Unfortunately, just one 10 billion ton asteroid would not be enough to terraform the planet. Over the course of decades, Mars would need to be bombarded with asteroid after asteroid. With each impact, more greenhouse gases would be added to the atmosphere. But in order to reach levels that would raise the temperature enough to sustain life, there would need to be dozens of impacts. With each asteroid strike, the planet would undergo a period of warming followed by a period of cooling until all the surface particles that were ejected into the atmosphere settled back on the Martian surface. This means using asteroids to terraform Mars could work, but it would take centuries to accomplish. Perhaps the easiest way to terraform Mars is by doing what we're doing to our own planet, by setting up factories and burning fuels that release CO2 and other greenhouse gases into the air. We could create climate change on Mars. This would not be a cost-effective method to terraform the planet, as a lot of materials and resources would need to be brought from Earth, but it could theoretically work. We'd have to launch countless missions with supplies and colonists to build settlements and factories on the surface of Mars. The terraforming communities would need to live in biodomes and artificial habitats for centuries until the terraforming process could be completed. But given enough time and resources, we could create greenhouse gas factories on the surface of Mars. As of right now, we don't know all the fuel sources or natural resources available on Mars, so early expeditions would need to gather intel for the colonization of the red planet. Once we knew exactly what was available, we could supplement it with materials from Earth or harvested from asteroids. The colonists could set up giant factories where they burn Martian rocks and heavy metals. They could also run air conditioning machines that produce chlorofluorocarbons. Chlorofluorocarbons are gases that destroy ozone here on Earth and were molecules generated through the use of appliances such as old air conditioners and refrigerators. Scientists eventually discovered how damaging they were to the atmosphere, and now chlorofluorocarbons are banned in most countries. But they would be incredibly useful as greenhouse gases on Mars. By burning certain substances, releasing chlorofluorocarbons, and melting the ice caps of Mars, colonists could now slowly change the atmosphere without nuking the planet or slamming countless asteroids into it. Obviously, one of the main issues with this plan is the colony would need to be set up first, which would require tons of resources and take a very long time. But in the end, humans would have a new planet to live on, so it might all well be worth it. There may also be a way to increase temperatures on Mars from space. This does not negate the fact that greenhouse gases still need to be increased, but some scientists think that by using a giant mirror, the Martian surface could be warmed up considerably. The craziest part of this plan is that the mirror would need to be very, very large. In fact, The mirror would have to be able to shine light on one entire side of the planet. It's important that the mirror intensifies the sunlight across the entire surface, because if it's only focused on one area, the greenhouse gases generated from the warming rocks wouldn't be enough to create global temperature change. The more surface that's being hit by the reflected sunlight, the more evenly distributed the temperature will rise. This also would cause the melting of the ice caps and the release of carbon dioxide trapped within the Martian rocks. But like with the nuking plan, the mirror itself will not be enough, since there just aren't enough greenhouse gases on the surface of the red planet. So the best terraforming solution for Mars is probably a combination of all the strategies mentioned. Maybe we detonate nukes at the poles to get things going. This would be followed by a greenhouse gas-rich asteroid slamming into the planet. Finally, a giant mirror would continuously bombard Mars with intense light. Then, after decades of waiting for things to settle, we could send an army of spaceships filled with colonists and engineers to build factories to make chlorofluorocarbons and release carbon dioxide. There are also other problems that we need to solve, even after we raise the temperature of the planet. Once we get the greenhouse gases to the right levels and Mars reaches a habitable climate, we'll need to put oxygen into the atmosphere for us to breathe. Oxygen is not a greenhouse gas, but it's definitely something we'll need in order to survive on the newly terraformed Mars. The best way to generate enough oxygen to sustain life on Mars is to grow plants across the planet. Unfortunately, plants take carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere to conduct photosynthesis, which then releases oxygen back into the air. This would be slightly counterproductive, as humanity just spent decades or even centuries trying to build up the amount of greenhouse gases on Mars. A solution to this might be that when increasing greenhouse gases on Mars, we slightly overshoot the number needed so there's enough for the plants to use while also maintaining a warm climate. However, growing plants on Mars is easier said than done. The Martian soil is devoid of all nutrients, which means we'll need to find a way to fertilize the entire planet. Once we're able to create dirt where pioneering species like lichen, fungi, and bacteria can thrive, they'll convert rocks and sand into usable soil like here on Earth. Think of it kind of like plants colonizing a new island that's formed in the middle of the ocean. Except instead of an island, it's an entire planet, and instead of an ocean, it's the vastness of space. We may have to do some genetic engineering to give these pioneering species the ability to thrive on Mars first. But by the time we're at that step in the terraforming process, who knows what kind of crazy technology we'll have available to us. With all the talk of nuking, harvesting resources, and changing the atmosphere of Mars, comes an ethical question. Do we even have the right to modify an entire planet to suit our needs? On the one hand, there's no living things on Mars, as far as we know. If we were to discover that there was microbial life or Martians living below the surface of the planet, that would change everything, or at least it should. NASA has gone to great lengths to ensure anything that's landed on the red planet is thoroughly sterilized and doesn't carry with it microbes from Earth. Certain bacteria and other extremophiles can survive in the most hostile conditions, and it's not out of the realm of possibility that with the right adaptations, they could find a way to thrive on Mars. But if there are already microbes living on the planet that have yet to be discovered, would it still be okay for us to change their environment? Even if there are no living things on Mars, should the humans of Earth bombard one of our planetary neighbors with nuclear bombs and asteroids? These are questions to take into consideration when planning to terraform an entire planet. With the way things are going on Earth right now, we might not have a choice. Between overconsumption of resources and the amount of damage we're doing to the environment, sending humans to another planet might be an inevitability. But there's also the argument of putting all your eggs in one basket. If anything were to happen to Earth, like a gamma ray burst blowing our atmosphere into space, or a giant asteroid impact decimating all life on the planet, the human species would go extinct. For right now, we have no backup plan for our species. Therefore, it could be argued that terraforming Mars isn't just a good idea, but necessary for the continuation of the human race. What it comes down to is that we do not have the technology to do this quite yet. And just to reiterate our initial point, nuking Mars will not allow us to terraform it. So we should probably throw that idea out the window. No matter what Elon or any other futurist says, terraforming Mars is just not possible with today's tech. If and when we do finally have the ability to terraform a planet, it'll likely be done using a combination of different techniques discussed in the video. We'll probably need a magnetic shield, a giant mirror, and a way to pump greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. Asteroids and the resources they contain will be incredibly important, not just for terraforming Mars, but for the future of space exploration in general. The only way any of these dreams will become a reality is if we listen to science and continue shooting for the stars, both figuratively and literally. Space exploration has slowed considerably since the Apollo missions that first landed humans on the moon. If nothing else, Elon and other private space companies have reinvigorated our interest in space travel. However, we'll need to continue to fund scientific missions and technological research if we're ever going to successfully terraform Mars. Now watch the real problem with living on Mars. Or check out what would happen if we detonate a nuke in space.